This morning I wanted to give some teaching and encouragement on how we can hear the voice of God and how this is something that is true. It's not just some like mystical like, ooh, the voice of God, but it's legit. And part of prayer and part of prayer and fasting is that we are positioning ourselves to just hear from the Lord, to hear from God, to have those life-giving words spoken to us, over us, so that then we can speak that outwardly as well to others who need life, who need to hear that life-giving word that comes from God. It doesn't come from us, doesn't come from a really good motivational speaker who has lots of followers on Instagram, but truly the life-giving words from God. And I believe he wants to, and he does, and he speaks to us, and he wants to speak to each and every one of us. Have you heard the phrase, Christianity is not a religion, but a relationship? Who's heard that? Or maybe you've said that. Yeah, I've said that a lot, and it's true. Our faith in Jesus, it's not this religion of you have to do all of these things, check it off, make sure you're perfect, to then maybe get some type of, like, goodness from this foreign, distant God. No, our faith is about a relationship with our Heavenly Father. It's about a relationship with the God who created the heavens and the earth, or the heavens and the earth, but also created us as well. And he wants to be with us. He wants to relate with us. And part of any relationship needs communication, right? And so not only are we talking to God, but God is talking to us. And I'm reminded always back to the creation narrative. And a lot of times throughout Scripture, the writers bring people back to this perfect, idyllic, just what God intended picture of creation. In Genesis 1 and Genesis 2, when God is creating the heavens and the earth, it says like God spoke or God said. So his very words were actually creating life. Said God said, let there be light, and whew, light happened. It wasn't like a theoretical thought process or anything. It was like, no, his words, just who God is, his speaking brings life. And that is a powerful thing. And that is something that has not changed. Like his words still bring life. So God's words and his voice give life, plain and simple. And so we are in this relationship with God, where his voice and his words are bringing us life. In Psalm chapter 1, it talks about how those who delight in the law of the Lord, which is his words, and listen to his voice, are like trees planted along the riverbank. That's health right there. When you are planted along a riverbank, like you are a strong tree. But if you look at like in a desert landscape, there's like nothing. It's always death, and it's just like dry, and it's like, ugh. But those who are with God's words and are listening to God's words have life. And so in that creation account, in Genesis, in Garden of Eden, God gives words. He gives direction. Adam and Eve choose to go against his words, and they go on the path of death. And that's just what we see, the results of them saying, no, I'm not going to follow God's life-giving words. I'm going to go my own way. And they follow the path of death. That's in Genesis 3. It was away from God. It was directly against God's words. But the result of that is God just saying, all right, I'm done with you all. No. The result is, I'm going to bring you back. I'm going to literally move heaven and earth. I'm going to bring you back into relationship with me. That happens through Jesus. God does the work to restore our relationship. He does the work even though it was our fault, even though we're the ones who are guilty of like, yeah, we knew it was right and wrong and we chose wrong and it's us, man. God's like, I will still fix it and I will bring you back into relationship with me through my son, Jesus. So we can dwell with him and be in relationship and be in a restorative relationship with our Heavenly Father. In John 10, verse 27, in the ministry of Jesus, as he's talking to different people, he says, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. This is something that is showing relationship. when it comes to our faith with Jesus, that he knows us. It isn't just like he's some, like, I don't know who that person is. Like, no, he knows us, but we also know his voice. And when we follow his voice, we are following the path of life. This is in the context of Jesus showing that he's the good shepherd. And with the beautiful imagery in there, sheep need to be led. And he talks about how he is the good shepherd. He will lay his life down for his sheep. But also, sheep are, like, interesting, where they will hear certain whistles and certain things that shepherds kind of have for their flock, and they follow it. And they're like, oh, that's where my shepherd is. And so what Jesus is really showing just us through this example, but also the people he's teaching, is it's like when we truly submit to the ways of Jesus and are following after him, we will hear his voice because he knows us. He knows what we need. He knows where to guide us, where to lead us. And so we need to then hunker down and actually listen to his voice because he is speaking, and we will follow that good and life-giving voice of Jesus. He knows us. He knows us by name. He cares about us. He died for us. His love is far beyond our own understanding. In a book I just got done reading by a pastor friend of mine named Ben Dixon called Hearing God, he has this quote in there that has stuck with me for a little bit. And it says this: the devil knows our name and calls us by our sin, but the Lord knows our sin and calls us by our name. There's a beauty in there of the devil just wants to just try to bring you back to who you once were, or like what your actions show and prove. Like, you're just a this, you're just a that. The Lord knows that, but he knows our names. He knows the names of our kids who have fallen astray. They know the names of our family members, of our friends. He knows them, and he loves them, and he cares for them, and he is calling out to them. He is always doing that. He was always sending his words out. But then again, we need to hear that voice and listen to it and heed it. And so we're going to talk about what this looks like, how this can be within our discipleship, and just some of the kind of biblical theology of what it means in our 21 days of prayer and fasting to hear the voice of God. Before we move on, let's go ahead and pray. Lord Jesus, again, we gather here to receive from you, Lord. Jesus, speak through me. Holy Spirit, speak through me. Let it be your words and not mine. We give you all the glory and all the praise and all things, God. And again, what a privilege it is to be in relationship with you, God. The heaven, I mean, you created all things, but yet you choose to still be in relationship with us because you love us. And so, God, we give you all the glory in that. In Jesus' name, amen. You can probably hear my voice is going a little weird. That grog that's happening through, like, the entire world, it seems like. Hold on. It's hit us, too, a little bit. But now I just sound like some really good, like, rock and roll artist who's been touring for, like, 70 years and, you know, can just go studio session anywhere in Nashville. I'm like, oh, your voice is awesome, man. Sounds like you've been a rock star. Yeah, totally, man. I'll tell you about it. So I can use that to my advantage with it. Because, sorry on the sidetrack, but like when I hear myself, like on my messages, I'll listen to myself sometimes. I'm like, man, my voice sounds weird. Like, I have a high voice, and I sound like, oh. So when I hear myself right now, I'm like, I sound cool. Like, I sound like I have authority right now. Yeah. So, but yeah. Anywho, so we've just finished our first seven days of our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And I want to just remind us that if you want to journal in that little resource area back there, we have journals. If you have signed up for the emails, great. That's the way that I do it, foursquareprayer.org. But essentially, we're committing these 21 days of prayer, of every day, just saying, I'm going to read God's word, I'm going to pray, and I'm going to also listen to what God has to say during this time. Also, some of us have chosen to fast, which means to deny some things that are in our normal life functions so that we can just be maybe a little bit more open a little bit more uncomfortable. And that's kind of why I did the chairs like this, was to make it a little uncomfortable. And it was funny. Everybody who came in had a different reaction of like, oh, interesting, you know. And part of that is just to just change it up a little bit, because I believe when we just do something a little bit out of our comfort zone, it attunes our ears to hear from God a little bit more. And that's part of even why we fast, is that we do something that makes us uncomfortable so that our hearts are open and our ears are open and our minds to just hear from the Lord and maybe to see something from God's word just jump out at us. So that's part of this prayer and fasting time too, is that we are saying no to some of the like gratifications of the flesh. Not that everything we're saying no to is bad. We're just saying, you know what? I'm just going to say no to some stuff, and I'm going to say yes to replacing that with more of God's word, more prayer time, more worship time, whatever it is, just so you can be more in tune with what God might be wanting to speak to us. I don't know about you, but the 21 days of prayer and fasting, I pray that it's not just like, I'll just do this. I pray that like this is an intentional thing of like, man, our world's kind of jacked up, and I just need to just really pray and fast, because I don't know what's going on. Or there might be some personal things going on. You need some breakthrough. You need a word from the Lord. You need some wisdom in a decision or in some direction, whatever it might be. But my prayer is that we're doing this with some intention, that we're truly being like, man, at the end of these 21 days, I want some direction, God. Like, here's some things in my life that I'm just a little just cloudy on, or I'm just feeling off. I'm just feeling like, I don't know. Like, my heart is that this is a time that God will be speaking to us, and that he will be able to truly either encourage us in something or else just kind of slowly move us a little bit different in some different ways. And so that's my heart in this. I pray that's yours as well. But so again, in this time, I really believe it's good that we understand that God wants to speak to us. And our next point is this: God's voice and words are always saying these things. He says a lot of stuff, but primarily it's this: I love you, I forgive you, I have plans for you, and follow me. Throughout the scriptures, Old Testament, New Testament, you can see this in the writings, the prophets, the law, the mission and message of Jesus, the letters of the epistles. Are all of these things coming back to what God is always saying? He doesn't say, you're stupid, you're a failure, shouldn't have done this, man, whatever, you have no future. Like, that's not what God ever says. He says, I love you, I forgive you, I have plans for you, follow me. And that last word, or those last two words, follow me, are the hardest in what God speaks to us. Because I think, like, as Americans, and Kirk and I were talking about this morning early here at the church, is sometimes we're just ingrained to, like, just get it figured out as Americans and, like, not surrender and, like, no. But part of following God is surrendering. And it's saying, like, I'm going to take my plans and submit them to your plans, God. And that's really tough. That's really hard to do. That's the gospel way. It's the Jesus way, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus is not just this additional buffet of options that we can choose from in our life of like, well, I got my life figured out. I'll add some Jesus to it and maybe a little bit of this, a little bit of that. And that sounds good. That looks good. Oh, sweet. No, like, Jesus is the whole meal. Like, he is everything. He is the whole. It is what we follow and what we submit to. He's not an addition to or a topping of anything. He is truly, truly everything that we have. And so when it comes to hearing God's voice, and we can easily, because like we said earlier, the enemy wants to just call us out by what we've done and just try to keep us in that identity. But God's voice is saying, I love you, I forgive you, I have plans for you, follow me. And we can, in our culture, drift away from those messages and find ourselves in the messages of the enemy, who's trying to take us down and just trying to have us believe in a false narrative of quote-unquote who we are. Like, you are a failure. Nobody will love you. Nobody will even care about you. You have no plan for your life. And that can be something that just gets spoken to us again and again and again. And all of a sudden, we start believing that voice rather than the true life-giving voice of God. Throughout my time as a youth pastor, as associate pastor, and in just in ministry, I've had a lot of sit-downs with people who will talk about, like, man, I don't know if I even hear from God, or I don't know if, like, I feel God, or, like, I just don't know. Like, it doesn't seem like God wants to speak to me. So usually I'll ask, like, spiritual triage questions of just simply, like, well, what do you think God's thoughts are of you? Or do you believe that you're forgiven? Do you believe in Jesus? If you believe in Jesus, like, what are some steps of response you've done? Or what was the last thing you read from your Bible? What do you remember about God's word? Just trying to, like, understand, like, where people are at. Because a lot of times, it's not that God is cut off and he's just, I'm not going to speak anymore. It's usually something with us. So not hearing from God is not a problem with God. It's usually a problem with us. An analogy that I think about this a lot that I think makes sense is our cell phones. We all have cell phones. In our house up by Mountain View Elementary, for some weird reason, we have AT&T, which is, like, solid, but, like, in our bathroom kind of hallway area, it just cuts out. Like, we have, like, no reception, and it happens all the time. We'll be talking to, like, family members or whatever, and all of a sudden, it's just like, we're like, oh, dang, that's right. We're in that weird little, like, blank spot. And it's not that, like, AT&T, their equipment is failing and it's cut out and nobody can hear from it. It's on our part. Like, our house has a certain, like, thing that's blocking the signal, like, right in this situation. So it's on us. And whenever we have a cell phone, you know, we're always trying to get the best reception. Like, we do weird things, like, can you hear me now? You know, and, like, going through glass and all that stuff. But with the voice of God, like, he is always consistently able to speak to us. It's more on us that we might need to adjust. We might need to reposture some things or do something a little bit different to hear from it. And usually it's because we've already, like, done this. We've turned our back. It's not that that God's gone away or he's any of that. It's just that we've just been, like, taking our heart a little bit and just kind of going, I don't think so. I'm going to go this way, which is away from the voice of God. But here's the thing. God will still speak to us. God's voice is still coming to us. And it happens time and time again. He wants to speak to us. God wants to speak to us and is speaking to us. We just need to adjust our lives to receive from him. We might need to deny some things. We might need just to cut out the other noise in our lives to truly receive and hear from the Lord. And again, what we see in the creation account for the Old Testament is God wanting to dwell with his people. He wants to speak to his people and be with them. And we just need to recognize that, like, God's already here. Like, he wants to speak to us. So let's chat. Let's speak. Let's have a heart posture to receive from him. In Psalm 95, verses 6 through 7, this is actually in one of our readings from our prayer and fasting time. I think it was, like, day 2 or 3. And this verse struck out to me in a really interesting way. It's in verse 7, but in verse 6 says this, "Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God. We are the people he watches over, the flock under his care." So that's, like, good. It's like this proclamation of he cares for us. He's watching over us. Like, he is still involved in our lives. And this last part of verse 7, "If only you would listen to his voice today." And that just, like, stood out to me like a sore thumb. I was like, oh, my goodness. Like, that is just a heart punch of a verse right there. And, like, I think the first thing that sometimes we might think is, like, well, yeah, like, our whole nation's going down because we don't listen to God's voice. Our culture's going down. Stupid politicians and Hollywood and young people this and blah, 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 news. But that verse is pretty clear. If only you would listen to his voice today. So it's about us and our relationship with God. Like, God is speaking. His voice is coming towards us. We need to listen to that voice. God's not a general sending out commands from a far-off base. He's real. He's relational. He wants to relate with his creation, with you and me, on a corporate level, but but also on an individual level. So that kind of begs the question, what prevents us from hearing God? Well, again, that verse is pretty clear, if only you would listen to his voice today. So I think number one is just like actually listening. my two young boys, when they're not listening, I'm like, just listen. And they're like, oh, you know, just like ADD little things. So I think part of it is that we actually just listen to God. Like we just stop and just quiet. And like with my two boys, I'm like, give me eyes. Like, let me see your eyes. They give me the eyes. Then I can like, hey, here's what I'm telling you. And they're like, oh. So if we just stop and just quiet our hearts, basically quiet the noise in our life, and the noise can be so many different distractors of our own agendas, I believe we just open up the floodgates even more to hear from God. There could be personal barriers to hearing from God. That could be unrepentant sin, hard hearts, our own distancing, our own just thought process of like, I got this thing figured out. And again, you do this subconsciously, but you turn and you start going away from the voice of God. And that's on the pathway of death. So what prevents us from hearing God is, again, ourselves. It's us. It's things that we need to adjust and that we need to work on and things that we need to bring before the Lord. And what's good is he loves us. He forgives us. He's not like, I told you so, you idiot. No, he really cares about us, and he wants to speak to us and encourage us. And so we need to just make sure that we don't have the barriers in our own lives that's preventing us from hearing from God. And I would say it's not preventing from God from speaking. It's our own blockage that we are choosing to say, I'm not going to listen to you with my headphones on. Like, No. So those are some key things. But then how do we actually hear from God? Here's some stuff that I want us to see the biblical theology on. The primary way is God's word. It's a little small on there, but I'll read it off for us. God's word, reading our Bible. So 2 Timothy 3:16, 2 Peter 1, these are key verses that talks about how God's word, the Bible that we read today, is God-breathed, God-inspired. It's something that is not just words on paper that are just like, oh, that sounds good. No, this is God's divine words, his voice speaking. And so the way that we primarily hear from God is reading his word, allowing the truth of scripture to speak to us through the Holy Spirit. In that 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20, it says, above all, you must realize that no prophecy in scripture ever came from the prophet's own understanding or from human initiative. No, these prophets were moved by the Holy Spirit, and they spoke from God. Like, there's some key things there that we need to remind ourselves that God's word is holy. This is his voice speaking to us and speaking for us that we can also use to speak life into other people's lives as well. So how do we hear from God? Number one, God's word, reading our Bible. Secondly, it's sometimes called the still small voice, but it's God's spirit. This comes in times of prayer, the Holy Spirit leading. It can just be all sorts of great things. And it sounds weird when I talk to my youth students a lot about this because they would have questions. And I feel like when you can communicate things on a level for a kid or a youth student, that is great because it's not like this whole theological like, blah, 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 with 10,000 references. It's just like, here's what it is. And I'm like, hey, have you ever had like that inner voice in your head when you're like watching something, and you're like daydreaming? And they're like, oh yeah, that happens like all the time. And I'm like, yeah, because we're humans and all that stuff. And I was like, what we start to notice is when that voice really aligns with God's word and starts to lead us forward in a path that is God-honoring and something that brings goodness, something that helps us love God and love people. That's when we start to recognize that still small voice of the Holy Spirit when he's speaking to us. That's when it's something that becomes really true and good. We're going to have like those inner thoughts where it's going to be things that are like not good. That's our flesh. Those are things that we say no to. It talks about in God's word that we have to weigh those thoughts and make sure that they're God-honoring or not. That's the flesh. But when that voice is leading us into ways that are going to be loving God and loving people in a good, biblical, healthy way, that's the Holy Spirit leading us forward. And so God speaks to us a lot of times in there. Either you're like at like the grocery store, you're like, man, I just feel like I need to just say hello to this person. And all of a sudden that one hello turns into a 25-minute conversation about life and faith. You're not praying for that person. That's that still small voice of God speaking and prompting and leading us into a certain way. Or you could just be simply driving down the road, listening to some worship music or whatever, and all of a sudden you're just like, get a person's name in your head, and you're like, huh. You're like, I should probably call them. And you call them, and they're like, oh my goodness, thanks for calling. Like, I'm just in a hard situation right now. Like, well, that was the Holy Spirit telling me to do that. Or it can simply be that still small voice, just scripture reminding. There's been multiple times where I'll just be like in life, just doing things, kind of thinking through like a certain situation, or like, I don't know, God, this, that, or the other. And like a verse just kind of comes into mind, or like the generalization of a verse. Here's the thing that I've also learned. Verses, memorization is good. It's not one of my strong suits. I know area codes, not the street address of verses. That makes sense? Like I know like the generalization of like this scripture in this area says this big truth. That helps me then go back to God's word to actually read it verbatim. But I'm not one of those pastors that can rattle off like 1,000 scriptures memorized. There's some people who are just gifted in that, and like, thank you, Jesus, for them. I'm not, I work on it too. I'm like, I'm trying to memorize scripture, but it just doesn't stick all the time. I think also because I have 2 small kids right now and life happens, there's also that. But truly, God's Spirit will speak to us, remind us of those certain scriptures at times. Also, God speaks through other people, trusted, aligned with God's word. If you read through the book of Acts, you'll see all throughout this time, Holy Spirit-empowered people are coming together, and they're talking through things, and they're sending apostles out, and they're doing the things of Jesus, and they're saying, hey, I believe God's speaking this in your life, and they pray over them and send them out. Just like in this circumstance with Miss Susan, she was asking some people and asked, hey, can you pray with me? It's like, yeah. And people are able to speak into her life and agree on things and give encouragement. And so other people can be used by God to speak for him, to help in that. And then lastly, audibly. It's not as common, but it can still happen today. I will definitely say this. I have never heard the voice of God like audibly. Like from the mountains, I've talked with people who have, and I believe these people because they are trustworthy people. They're not some like mountain kook who's like, I hear God all the time. You know, it's like, okay, like these are like people who are just like, no, like I, like this happened. Like God spoke and it was, and it's like, I believe you, you know, and I'm like, I want to hear that too. And we see in scripture, God speaking audibly. There's been lots of other recorded moments throughout history post Jesus time of God speaking audibly as well. And this can happen. But the primary way that we see is through God's word and reading our Bible, letting that speak to us and be firm and life-giving for us. And so that's what we're doing in these 21 days of prayer and fasting. And that's what we're going to actually do in these next time right here as a church body, is we're going to take like 20 minutes to say, all right, Lord, speak. Lord, do something. Say something. Let your words jump out towards me. And so we're going to use this method called lecto divina, which means divine reading. Basically, it's you're reading, you're reflecting, you're responding, and you're resting. You're letting God's Spirit speak to you. So the first one is read, or lecto. You read the passage slowly, and I'm going to have some paper, and we're going to have some Bibles available as well. And you read through that for about 5 minutes. And the question is, what words or phrases jump out to you? And it's going to be on these little papers I'm going to pass out as well. The second one is reflect, or meditatio, which is Latin. I don't even know if that's what Latin sounds like, but sounds good to me. You read the passage again. What emotions does it stir up? Is there anything God is saying to you personally through the passage? So it's again, opening up our hearts and our minds to hear from God as he's speaking through his word and through the Holy Spirit. Third, respond, oratio. Again, latte. read the passage again. Is there a response or action step God is inviting you to take? So there's a response time. And then the last one is a rest time, where you're just letting that passage sink over you one more time. So we're going to read through Psalm 86, 1 through 13, four different times. And each time you're reading through it slowly, and you're allowing God to speak to you through his words, and letting that become just the truth that you're letting jump out for you. And then on the end of that, there's a little kind of question that I want to lead us in as well about one word. So here's what's going to happen. I'm going to have a few of us just kind of pass out these. Hey, Mike, can you grab some and just pass them down? If you have a Bible with you, get it out. If you have an iBible, great, on your phone. Just take one and pass it down throughout the aisles. We have more Bibles in the back by the sound booth. If you need a Bible, we can get one to you. And then also, there's some pens up here. So I'll just leave them up front here. So if you need a pen, you can grab one of those so you can write on this piece of paper. So what's going to happen is I'm going to put a 20-minute timer up on the screen. It's going to just count down for 20 minutes. And then we're going to have some just soft music in the background. And the first 5 minutes, you're doing that first question, which is read. Read the passage slowly. What words or phrases jump out at you? So that's all you're doing for the first 5 minutes. And then second, after that 5 minutes, I'll get on the microphone and kind of prompt us. It goes into reflection time. You read the passage again. What emotions does it stir up? Is there anything God is saying to you personally through this passage? Let me go on and on. So that'll take the whole 20 minutes. And after that's done, we'll kind of just sum up our time, pray, and then we'll be free to go. And so again, my heart is that we're doing some intentional reflection of God's word in prayer time. We're talking about hearing from God. And so I really want the word to just give us some time to hear from him as well. So, Diana, if you want to go ahead and push play on the music and then that little timer, that'd be perfect. We're actually going for 20 minutes, guys, so buckle in. I think I want to just ask the question, who can I sense that they maybe were hearing from the Lord and just kind of getting some direction on some things as they're reading through some of that scripture? Just raise your hand. Yeah. Yeah. And I think that's the beauty of God speaking to his people, is it happens. It's there. I was just kind of like, oh, that's an interesting dichotomy. Like verse 1, bend down, O Lord, and hear my prayer. Answer me, for I need your help. It's a pretty desperate opening. And you go down to verse 13, kind of the end of our little section. The psalmist says, for your love for me is very great. You have rescued me from the depths of death. I just love that. Like, at first, like, man, Lord, just bend down and hear my prayer and my cry. I'm freaking out, God. And I've prayed that prayer a multitude of times. Then we see later on, just a reminder that your love for me is really great. You have rescued me from the depths of death. That's a good encouragement there, that God is with us in that. So what I want to encourage us in, I'm going to pray for us and we'll be done here, is the last little bit on that piece of paper. It says, another helpful tool for our discipleship is asking God for one word that can help define this upcoming year or season of life. What is that one word that you sense God leading you to? This is something that I've done sometimes in my life, sometimes I haven't. This year I'm choosing to kind of get back on that horse again and really just, all right, Lord, like, what is that word or what is something that you can kind of help steer my own discipleship, my own life in, or maybe even the life of our church in? So as we've talked about hearing from God, kind of a challenge for you in this upcoming week is ask God, like, is there a word that kind of defines some things for this upcoming year? Maybe it's trust or faith, or maybe it's purity or whatever it can be, like something that can just be a part of your everyday that you're just reminding yourself in that God wants to speak to you about and lead you in. And so I want to encourage you that as you saw and just practice here during a Sunday service, we can listen to God. We can hear his voice through the scripture. We can also ask God, God, give me a word. Like, give me something that kind of gives some direction. And I have faith that God will speak to you if you're also putting in the work to hear from him. And so you can use this method, this Lectio Divina. You can do it in 4 minutes. You can do it in 20 minutes. You can do it in an hour. Like, it's up to you to do it. You can do one verse and just reflect on that and read it a couple of times. Just really use it how you want to be used in that. But I wanted to equip us today, but also to show us that we can hear from God. And this is a good, good thing. And to be sensitive to his Holy Spirit also speaking to us in the everyday normal parts of our life as well, as God leads us and guides us through his Spirit in so many things. So I'm going to pray for us. And then afterwards, Diana, if you want to put that kind of calming music on still, if you want some prayer, if there was something that you felt like God just sparked in your writing, that you're like, I would like some prayer. I want to just invite you to come up to these front chairs, and I'll be up here, and there'll be a few other people from our prayer team up here as well to pray for you and with you. If you feel like, I just need somebody to stand with me in this. There was something that I received from God, and I'm kind of like, I don't know, like I'm still just having a hard time grasping this, or I have a prayer request for my family or my kids or this, that, and the other. Like, let's pray with you and for you in that. And so after I pray for us, we'll have that kind of just chill music, and feel free to come up forward here, and there'll be a few of us to pray with you in that. So, Lord Jesus, thank you again that your word is true, is powerful. It is your words, Lord, your voice, and remind us that we have access to that. We have access to your voice and to your words. And so, God, thank you that you still speak to us and you want to speak to us. God, as we go about our days and our weeks, remind us to be empowered by your Spirit and to be led by your Spirit and to be just found firm on your word and on that truth that you speak to us, God, that you speak life into our lives, that we can be life-giving in return to the people and places that you have called us to. And so, Lord, we give you all the glory in these things, and we pray this in your mighty name. Amen. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he shine his face upon you and give you his peace. Amen. So if you need some prayer, we'd love to pray with you during this time. Other than that, feel free to mingle and get a little warm coffee so you can bear it outside in the cold. So.